You must take the A train, but you're going to want to transfer to the C at Hoyt Skimmerhorn to catch the Central Brooklyn Jazz Consortium's panel on women in jazz. Female musicians like trombonist Melba Liston, saxophonist Vi Red, and guitarist Emily Remler, they didn't get the recognition they deserved in their day. But here to talk about female jazz pioneers and the place of women in the genre, and trumpet some of their own work, are saxophonist, educator, and bandleader Lakecia Benjamin. Welcome to Woman 2BK.
Thank you.
And flautist and saxophonist Gabrielle Garo, who's participating on the panel later this month. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
So how did you guys get started in jazz? Gabrielle, maybe we'll start with you.
How did I get started in jazz? So I guess I'll start with some of my background. My dad is Dominican from Puerto Rico, and my mom's from New Orleans. So a lot of that has definitely influenced, you know, the way I perceive things, the cultural backgrounds, and they're two different cultures, but they've really influenced me, and I've definitely have seen it projected into my playing. And growing up, just listening to the music, learning more of my culture and my family and everything else of that sort, and definitely being inspired by those that have come before me, just listening, practicing, performing, and being so fortunate to do all that I've done so far.
My family is African American, but I was born and raised in Washington Heights, New York, so I grew up playing a lot of merengue. So my first like upbringings were like from Haleo books, maybe you could relate, and like just really old school stuff. So when I got to high school, I was studying with a guy named Bob Stewart, who's a tuba player, and he was bringing all kinds of people like Steve Coleman, Nicholas Payton, Sam Rivers Band to our actual like school to show us. So it was through that transition of moving and having to like, you know, now learn this new art form that I started to discover all the masters and legends and really like see like the world's like was infinite possibilities.
So I don't know that much about jazz. I like what I hear, but I have no idea sort of about like the greats.
Yeah.
And as we mentioned, I'm sure that there are a lot of women pioneers who have gone sort of under-recognized. So I'm wondering if you guys want to shout out like any woman who plays a saxophone or a flute who you consider to be great, but maybe didn't receive the recognition in her own day.
I could list. I mean, back in the early 20s, there was a big band called the International Sweethearts of Rhythm, and they were all
great name.
Yeah, yeah, they were an all. They did integrate later on, but they started off as an all African American female band. So a big band that's five saxes, five trombones, five trumpets. The woman you mentioned, Vi Red, she was in that band. So they started. There's Melba Liston. I mean, there's so many people. Terry Lynn Carrington now, Tia Fuller, Esperanza Spalding.
Sure.
So the tradition has really started to grow, and more people take it on.
During that time too, like more specifically with like Mary Lou Williams, back in that era, there was, you know, I guess it was oppression in a sense where it's like women were not given that panel that we have now in 2019 and so on. And when World War II came, that's when a lot of the male musicians were going off to war, of course. So that opened up some of the opportunities for women. But then when they came back, whole other story.
Right, back in the kitchen.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And then, God, man, if you dared to still be a musician as a woman, that was just looked down upon. And then they would be harassed. They would deal with so many other remarks. It was crazy.
There's a story about this. Actually, the Sweethearts were at a club. They had been playing that club five nights a week, selling it out. And the day the war ended, and maybe next week, the guys came back. And they came back to play the night, and the club owner had packed all their stuff and put it in the corner.
Wow.
And they're like, where's our stuff? And they were like, the guys are back. What am I supposed to do? And that's how they took a break.
This sounds like one of my favorite movies, A League of Their Own,
yeah,
except with jazz instead of baseball. And I'm interested in seeing that movie. So please, somebody make it.
Yeah.
It also seems like there have been gender roles within jazz, maybe with the exception of this sort of time period that you're talking about, where like it's okay for a woman to be a vocalist or, I don't know, maybe play like certain instruments, but like other instruments are viewed as too masculine or off limits. Was that your guys' experience when you were coming up?
Personally, I did not face that at 9 years old. I started to realize that moving onward and going to some of the programs and being around my peers and then moving on to high school and then college, of course. But I've definitely learned since then that there are like stereotypes of what we should be doing. Even in college, I'm always mistaken as a vocalist or outside of school in general life. So,
What about you, Lakecia, as a saxophonist?
I struggled with that earlier on, looking for a mentor that played my actual instrument, like someone that, because I was like into Mary Lou Williams, I was into Terry Lynn, so many people, but there wasn't a like for the horn, it's a little more obscure for women. So, you know, if you get to the club, sometimes they'll be like, oh, are you carrying that for your boyfriend? Are you here? You know, to help the band.
Are you carrying that for your boyfriend?
Like, or like if you're coming to meet them.
Kind of a shitty boyfriend.
I'm not sure what they're thinking, right. But I've definitely had that. So
right.
That's kind of one of the things that's motivated me and inspired me to, like, I guess, get it more into education and stuff, because I think that's important for people younger and coming up to see that there are actually people that are playing the horn, the flute, the trumpet, and they have successful careers and they're doing well and it's being received well. And that if this is the road you want to go down, it's totally possible. And you can make even bigger changes than what I'm making now.
There's an article in the Times from a couple years ago where they talked about sort of sexism and gender bias in jazz. And they interviewed Camille Thurman, mm-hmm. who I believe is a saxophonist, and
yes,
went to LaGuardia High, where you guys both went. And she talked about how she felt like some of her male classmates were sabotaging their female peers, and she said a few of them made it really difficult for us females in the band, and that it led to some people dropping out, and that she actually considered not pursuing it as a career because of sort of the obstacles that were placed in her way. So I'm wondering if you guys had similar experiences, or were there moments in your youth where you were like, should I really be doing this, or is this going to be too hard?
Yes.
Gabrielle, go ahead.
Yes. Especially in high school, I've really dealt with that. You know, I started at 9. It wasn't as much in, like, elementary school because we were all just, like, starting.
Yeah.
We're like, we want to do this. Cool. But then it gets more serious as you progress into some of the more serious programs, like the MAP Music Advancement Program at Juilliard, Jazz and Lincoln Center. And so as I was progressing in high school, I really dealt with that, especially being... I was very fortunate to have, like, some roles to be, like, the musical director for, like, a production and things like that. So, of course, I was that one girl telling the guys what to do, and then you could imagine how that went.
You had a target on your back.
Yeah. I've dealt with, you know, guys stepping on my music and things like that, but I feel like it's something that I embrace now, you know? It's really something that I've grown into, and, like, you learn to love yourself regardless of the, you know... the detours and things you've had to go through.
And how do you push back when somebody steps on your music or bullies you in that way? Like, what tools do you use?
To be graceful. Mm-hmm. You do it in a graceful way, but you gotta be stern and let them know what it is.
Mm-hmm. It just sucks that in so many of these, like, male-dominated industries, that part of your brain has to be going to that instead of to music and studying. What about you, Lakecia?
I mean, I guess we're sort of all biased here because Camille, me, and her, well, went to LaGuardia.
Right.
So, and I went at the same time. So there was these factors going on, and I agree with Gabrielle. The older you get, the more it becomes, I guess your awareness goes up too. So you start to see things you may not have seen when you were, like, in elementary school. For me, the greatest time I really started to see it happening was once I got to college. And I was going out to the jam sessions, trying to make a mark, starting to really get with solid work. That's when I noticed, like, you know, if there's 90 people at the jam, 88 are men. So now you're out there in the wee hours of the night with nothing but men, and there's a certain mentality of why you probably are here, and it's probably not for the same purpose.
I'm curious about how or if that impacts your musicality or the way that you play. I don't know, like, do people... I feel like often people are like, oh, you know, this person's style is, like, very feminine or, like, masculine. Are those words that are used to describe... I don't know, the way that people play in jazz?
People tell me I sound beautiful, uh-huh. I sound cute, it was a pretty solo. Versus with the guys, they're like, oh, that was killing, that was amazing, oh, you a monster, oh my God. You know, more like, and I'm at, I may not still to this day understand if it's accurate or it's personal.
Right.
Because what
right.
is a cute solo?
Right.
Like,
right.
are you actually meaning positive things, like, oh, this is the thing I relate to you, or do you actually mean... cute little girl solo. So there are different, like I said, there's definitely different things and different ways you have to interact with the guys. Mm-hmm.
And then also, like, the phrase, like, play like a man, or, like, you know.
Yeah, right. What does that mean?
Someone told me once I play like a big, fat old man.
And, like, what is that?
You're like, I'm good, actually.
I understood what they meant, and right. I had a weighty sound. But
right.
I was like, that's the visual you get, I guess. With it.
Right, and it's the idea that you can't have a weighty sound or a sound with gravitas or play like a monster if you're not
Well, we're fighting the stigmas and stereotypes that have already been established. So, and whenever you're breaking new ground, someone is looking for something familiar to hold on to.
Right.
So I try not to sometimes be too hard on them, especially if it's an audience member. You're just living your truth. And slowly, the more you see me, the more you see us, you'll have a new perspective.
Another question that I want to ask you guys is, I like interviewing women who are killing it in male-dominated fields. But at the same time, I know that it can be really tiring, and that having to be the women who come forward and talk about their experience as women in the industry is it can be difficult, and also that if it's not done right, it can feel like tokenism, right? Where it's like, oh, I wish actually you would interview me about my amazing skills as a musician on a mixed panel rather than like having me come on and be the person to talk about gender all the time. Do you guys have fatigue about this? Are you tired about like talking about women in jazz? And if so, is there a better way to address this issue?
We'll get tired of talking about it when things change. I think sometimes you have to keep pressing and pressing your way through the issue. And sometimes I do wish, in interviews that are not based on a theme, sometimes that, you know, if it's a male journalist, they may say the first thing to me, how does it feel being a woman in jazz? Versus, like, how does it feel to even be a musician? Because I'm not really sure there's a difference in terms of with what you're asking. But like I said, I try to be understanding and compassionate, because while it's the norm to me, because I've been a woman my whole life, it's very, very new all over the world. So I just try to understand, you know, soon this question won't need to be asked.
I really look forward to that day when we can stop being like, what's it like being a woman in X field?
Yeah.
Normal would be the great answer.
I think it's also about, like, how can you get tired of something that is your reality? You know, how can you get tired of talking about that? How can you get tired of creating awareness for it? Especially, like, other things going on in the news today. You know, that's people's realities. And I feel like Keisha said, until change is made and, you know, we're being heard more, which we are being heard more in 2019 as well, I think that it's just something that's great to address on even bigger platforms and continuing to get that out there.
And Gabrielle, we'll stay with you, and maybe you can tell me about this panel that you're going to be on coming up.
Yeah, so with the panel, I was asked to be a part of it, and I'm so happy to be a part of it, especially with like other women that are just out in this industry and making a mark. And there are women before me as well that I look up to. So I'm proud to be a part of it. And we will be discussing, you know, I assume we will be discussing topics like this as well.
That's great. And it's the Central Brooklyn Jazz Consortium's 20th anniversary. They've got all sorts of events going on, but they have this specific panel that's on Saturday the 30th, I believe.
Yes,
is that March, right? Saturday, March 30th.
Yes.
And we'll be talking about women in jazz. So if people like this conversation, hopefully they'll come out for that.
That's great.
Thank you guys so much for joining us. Really appreciate
your
time.
Us.